Hello, thank you for having me. Super excited. Yeah, indeed, many things to show. So I'm gonna start for the in the boring part, which is oh, show screen. Yeah, for sure. There we go. I guess you are seeing my screen already. Oh wait, I need to monitor too. There we go. I hope now everything is okay and you can see my screen. Correct. Okay. So the title, Retargeting Skeletons and Souls. There is a good reason why I put these two concepts together. And it's because sometimes we are so obsessed in the retargeting process that we forget that we are doing characters. We are animating characters or we are just telling stories. Either if it's a video game or it's a movie, it's the same thing. We need to find how to bring the souls, the brief, the backstory of the characters into our skeletons, which is the technical part, but both work together. And it is true that this happens all across the industries where sometimes we feel like copy-pasted libraries of animation all over the place without taking care too much about the acting itself. It's normal. I mean, we are not professional actors most of the cases. You know, we see the animation library, we just drag and drop and looks cool. Let's go with that. A little bit of my background, I'm gonna go very fast on it. I don't want to bore you with, again, backstory and all the stuff. You can see here a icon, no worries. This is my past, my future is different, but it's just to represent how I've been always doing professional work, my own pilots and personal work in parallel. That's why I split always this slide into parts. I come of a background of working at MCCC, DNEG, ILM. In ILM is where I started to be quite interested in motion capture. I work in crowds in Avengers and Ready Player One. So I have to say that crowds actually is a space where you can merge the idea of video games for motion capture and VFX for motion capture. There's a lot of technicalities there in the crowd department that they are quite interesting. In parallel, I've been always working in my pilots, including Summer in 2014, the Seed of Juna released in 2020, yeah, and CRETE, which is my current project, fully on XSense with the help of some keyframe animators. But basically, most of the animation I do now is here in this living room or outside with on-body recording, which I can show you now a bit. Some of the stuff I do when I go outside with the real daylight, which is also healthy, by the way. The technical workflow. So the technical workflow is trying to find a way where while you automatize some of the tasks, you have also a very interactive and artistic approach. So I have here, for example, concepts as non-destructive motion editing with kind effects. Well, what I mean by that? So here we got a XSense animation. I can show you this in the very first step. So this comes directly from XSense. In fact, the animation is this one. I poorly recorded, as you can see, the X vector, the forward vector is not corrected. I did things very fast because I really don't care, because I know later I'm gonna correct whatever I need to correct. So this is just a normal jump animation. As you can see, my head of jumping is like a 5 years old kid. And that's it. That's all the things I got here. All this animation, 3 takes, 1, 2, 3, and then I come back, boom, done. With that motion, with that input, I can start painting animation, not just retargeting animation, but thinking about how I want to improve and enhance the animation. Because again, I'm not an athlete. I can't jump 3 meters. So the point now is, okay, this is animation from XSense. The first thing I need to do is to bring the root motion using the hip motion. This is something that I would like to see in the future, by the way, in XSense. I think it's something that could be implemented, but right now it's not a problem, being honest with you, because we can always extract the root motion. That's the node you're gonna see here. And you're gonna see this motion now moving using the hip information. At the same time, the root is extracted. The animation of the root is extracted. That's why the skeleton is on place all the time. Now, if I want this to work for gameplay, for video games, what I need to do is to bring this extracted temporal locomotion where into the root, because games use the root. If you are using root animation for attacks, for jumps, for any kind of gameplay event, root motion is how you move the capsule, the collision of the character. So this is not useful right now. What I need to do in the next node here, what I'm doing is, okay, take the point 25, which is the temporal locomotion in the spreadsheet here, well, 0 plus 1, 25 plus 1. This is the locomotion, the temporal locomotion. Now that is part of the route. So now the character here, if I go, I start the locomotion. Here you can see how it's moving only in X and Z. I don't want Y yet. Okay, there is a good reason for that, because I want to control Y motion. Why I want to control Y motion? Because I want to decide what is the height of the capsule. If this enemy or this character is jumping over an obstacle, I want to decide where the collision starts. The collision is going to start, if there is a capsule here, imagine a capsule of the character, the collision is going to start in the bottom axis here, and it's going to end depending on the height of your capsule. I want to control that. I will come to that very soon. Then I got the rig match pose, which basically is bringing my character here, which is, this is the character. What I do here is to match the pose. You can see the skeleton here is a pose. So what I do here is, with this note in Houdini, I'm matching the A pose into the T pose of XSense. I prefer to tweak my character pose rather than the motion pose for different reasons. It's depending on your taste. Sometimes you can even, if you want, you can also tweak here the T pose a bit, but I recommend you just to don't mess too much with the source animation, and you can play around more with the input character. Then it's very simple. I map all the points. You can see a dictionary here, what is what. This is very classic in any motion editing software, but also visually I can see all the constraints of the source skeleton. You can see here, you can see here, to the target skeleton. And the funny thing and the interesting thing of this is, because we are using full body IK, sometimes it doesn't matter if you have three spine joints. You see, this one is not connected. It doesn't matter, because it's going to be driven by full body IK. And IK means that this one is going to pull, this guy is going to pull all the bones in between. This head here is going to pull all the spine, obviously with different influences that you can play around. But at the end of the day, what you want is to be a puppeteer somehow, using the source animation into your character animation. So no worries if you don't find the same count of bones, it's all right. So then I go to the full body IK solver, and it's where I start to see the things happening here nicely. Sometimes it's not matching perfectly, but that's sometimes because I have by choice, depending on the height of the character, depending on the limbs, depending on how I want to feel the motion. But if I want changes here, I can also start tweaking the pose. And as you can see, I can match whatever I want going upwards. And that is quite related with the concept of non-destructive motion editing, which means any change I make upstream is going to affect downstream. I don't need to bake anything. I can bake, of course, but I don't need to bake anything. I can just go here and just start tweaking the things as I want. It is so important that even if I go to the last step where I can see my character here, I can still doing this and see my retargeting. Again, this is not even animation. This is just matching the pose, A pose to T pose, and I can start tweaking here the bones as I want. And as you can see, if you notice, I'm not just rotating the forearm. The body is adapting as a whole, because it's full body IK, it's not FK. You know, so if, for example, I start spinning one of the spines, you're gonna see that the effects are more global. You see? So this gives you a very artistic feeling of how the animation is looking. For example, if I go here, let's say in the very beginning, in this moment, and I do this, I can even animate this part, and then when it goes up, I can animate this part back with a lot of intention. So it's a kind of a smart way of animating while you are not an animator, because you are gonna, the full body IK is gonna bring the motion in a more natural way without needing to go to 20 controllers. Maybe you can take the spine, and just with the spine, you can have a very good feeling overall of the motion. More things. Constant visual feedback is more or less what we saw right now. Like, you have a constant feedback of how the source motion is affecting not just the skeleton, but the final geometry. Painting animation, the same concept. You are not animating, you are, artistically changing notes to have different feeling. So for example, if I go here, I got a note that is just for the fingers. So this one just corrects. No, this one is not the fingers. Oh, it's the fingers, actually. The thing is, I put a noise. So here you can see the fingers moving. I don't know why it's coming back there. Ah, because it's not this one. But yeah, basically, you can put any rig pose note here in the chain and start saying, oh, yeah, I like animation, but I don't know. I would like to see this guy maybe more like looking down. I can start animating all these guys already there in a different layer. So, and here I want them to look up again. Sorry, the scaling is bad. I did this very fast. So now I have a new layer of animation there, and I'm painting. I can just disconnect this and see all the changes in real time. And that's the beauty of working with nodes, that you can always have regrets, and it's okay. It's non-destructive. I'm not baking anything at all. So, yeah. Automatizing repetitive tasks. Once you have all the network more or less done, you can use, for example, in Houdini PDG, which is a system, a framework to automatize retargeting. You can use this for generic animation, but I have to be honest with you, I love to do motion editing. I love to have a lot of XSense animations in a library, and I like to blend them, to put them on top, to add different layers, to have a noise layer on top. So I love to have an artistic approach. To me, it's really, really important. Quick iteration, as you can see, I can change the things very fast. And root motions consideration is a bit painful. It's what you saw in the very beginning. I need to extract the root motion. I put the root motion back to the root. And that's because it's used in video games. I can show you that now in Unreal Engine. And yes, again, you need to do some axis consideration. This is a little more painful depending on the... this is like the problem is not the software, it's like conventions. Like every single software has a different Y. And different set and different X. The problem is usually X, Y, and Z. So even the forward vector sometimes changes as well. What I do here is a correction. The flat Y root here, basically, when I move from the full body IK correction, you can see that now this motion, this root is going down. So what I do here is flattening that. But not just that, in a second note, here is flat root motion, as you can see. But also, I'm going here in a new node, which is going to be this one, if I'm not wrong. And I'm animating also my root motion upwards. So in that way, I can also bring what is going to be the height of my characters, depending on how much I want them to jump. It's going to be slow because I'm loading 200 curves. But again, I can just now take the root motion and say, okay, I want this guy to jump 3 meters, 4 meters, 5 meters. And you can see all the animation there happening in the graph editor. So that's one of the things I work a lot. I got my source motion capture, and then I start adding layers on top. Because again, we are not superheroes. We can't jump 3 meters. We only can jump maybe 2 meters maximum. That's the workflow. I always tend to animate later on top all the time. Yeah, I think this is the note, actually. Yeah. So yeah, it's going to be slow. But basically what I do is animating in different layers, the root motion, the hips, anything I need for the gameplay events. So that's more or less about the technical workflow. Let's talk about the artistic workflow when motion capturing. I think this is quite relevant because technical workflow, we can use Motion Builder, we can use KineFX, Houdini, we can use Unreal Engine for retargeting as well. But I think something is missed sometimes is the artistic workflow to understand what is doing our character. For example, these characters that you saw here, the ancestors, one of the briefs I was quite obsessed is it's like imagine a human 2.0, a human body which is close to be perfect, like perfect engineering. It doesn't need to feel like a lot of weight, a lot of anticipation, a lot of mistakes while walking or running. It needs to feel almost perfect. And as you can see, I'm pretty sure, if not, you should, we have here a very emblematic character, the Teeth 1000 of Terminator 2. Which is so relevant for this kind of talk because explains how when an actor knows about the character, it's going to help the feeling of the motion capture. And to me, one of the things in my head about, not only for the keyframe animators, also when I put the XSense suit, I think, how I need to run, how I need to jump, how I need to dodge, how I need to attack. I need to attack with confidence. I need to attack with, like, if I was almost a robot. Because these characters, the ancestors, these guys, as you can see, they are very tall. They are not very fat. They are like, why, like Greek sculpture. You know, a little bit, of course, many people told me based in Prometheus. But again, Prometheus, the engineers are based on Greek sculpture and Elvis Presley, which we can argue that are perfect in their terms, you know, in rock and roll and in proportions. So the same thing with the ancestors. They need to feel perfect. They need to move nicely. Once you have this idea, you need to split this in three kind of areas where your animation is shot specific, gameplay specific, or library specific. Shot specific is any motion that is hero motion, like basically the main characters are doing a specific action. You talk that with the actors, you prepare the brief, you do the rehearsal, and then you move into that specific motion. I think it's pretty simple. Gameplay specific is a little bit different because there are more technical aspects. And I think in one of the previous presentations, they already mentioned like you need to be careful of how much the character can move, how the root motion is going to be oriented. Are you going to turn 90 degrees? It's more technical. And you need to keep in mind, most of the things you keep in mind is root motion. Most of the cases, if you use this for combat animation. And then we got library specific. This is like backups. I always, every single time I do a motion capture session with XSense, I have maybe 1 hour of the, let's say, shot specific and gameplay specific motion. And then I leave 20 minutes for libraries. And libraries, I usually even don't write down in a spreadsheet. What I do usually is to say, okay, let's do breathing animation. Let's do shaking animation. Let's do walking animation. Let's do getting up, going down. It's natural. And you start to bring, to have a big library of different animations. In fact, yeah, maybe I have even, for example, the other day I was doing, not part of the spreadsheet, but I was doing like twitches. Here, I think is this one. Yeah. I was doing like a lot of library animation. I'm going to show this one. I think it's the good one. Yeah, this is like for impacts. For example, when the character gets an impact, it's going to be used as additive animation, not as full animation. It's going to be, the character is going to be doing something. And if you hit to the character, it's processing, by the way, it's not a HD process yet. But what you're going to have is just this animation added on top of the animation that the enemy or the character is doing. So you are attacking, and while you are attacking, you have an impact in the shoulder. I have a specific library animation to add on top of that. So that's how I split the animation nature, shot animation, gameplay animation, and library animation. Library animation is also very used in crowds. Crowds, we had like tons of different walking loops, falling loops, recovery loops, that they are not specific for an action, is something that we need to have to back up, because you don't know when you're going to be in front of the computer working in a project. It's like, damn, I need a breathing animation. And I have like jumps and flip-flops and things like that, but I don't have a silly breathing animation. So I always try to do that in the very end of the sessions. Yes, and then anticipation, action, and recovery. This works for anything, any of the three specific animation areas. You need anticipation, you need action, and you need recovery. In the next slides, we're going to see how I work with anticipation, action, and recovery. Character design defines movement design. And this is quite important because, for example, these guys, the ancestors, this one should be okay, are very tall, are very strong. They define how the character moves. It's not just, oh, it looks cool. Yeah, it looks cool, but it needs to move cool, or at least related of the design. How is the shoulder structure? How is the chest? Is able to move the neck? These guys are going to move the neck way less than me because I'm not that strong. But these guys with this massive neck, as you can imagine, it's going to be more like an statue, like very, very robust, very, very still in place. I'm very confident with every single step. Very tall guys. So the character design is something that you need to bring these concepts to the actors, to yourself. You are going to put the suit, see this, spend 3 minutes looking to the proportions. Imagine how this guy is going to move. How you imagine this guy moving? Very long limbs. So you can have a interpretation already, very strong spine. For example, the spine is so strong, for the reason because they are so tall, and they still need to be perfect in their interpretation. So the only way of having a very tall guy with no back problems and no spine problems is bringing to the design very strong spine. And this also helps to me to when I do the motion, to improvise, you know, crazy movement with the spine because it's very, very large. I can do massive curves here, you know. So character design for sure needs to completely in a waterfall effect to define the movement design. Motion direct, again, this is quite related. Motion direction, the backstory, the biomechanics and intention, things that you need to think about. You need to write it down. You need to speak with the actors or to tell to yourself in the mirror, I know how this character moves. I'm going to put the suit. I'm going to give my 100%. And this is the difference between doing good motion capture and great motion capture. You don't want to leave any chance of doubts of, oh man, that feels so mock-up. It's so motion capture. Because the eyes of the audience is more and more, you know, trained. You need to put the suit and believe the character you are inside. Forget you are not Alvaro, you are not Mr. Smith, you are now that character. Put the music, drink something, whatever, you are now that character and the rest doesn't matter, okay? So for the actors or for yourself, the good versus great is a matter of training before putting the suit. And then taste. When it identifies when a good motion capture is good and bad, it's a matter of, you know, watching a lot of movies, playing a lot of games, being always very close of the data to understand, this doesn't feel with good weight. Talk with animators. Animators are going to give you a very good input if a motion capture is good or bad because they are working with animation all the day. Let's be clear. There is nothing like keyframe animation when you have a professional key animator. It's going to give you the best of the best. That doesn't mean that motion capture can't be great. The thing is, you need to bring animators into motion capture, either for motion editing or for feedback. It's quite important. I always show the motion capture to animators like, how you feel this? Oh, I think you can add a little bit of weight. And that's what I do in the animation in the very end. When I have this very boring jump, which is, I think, this one. Let me see. I'm gonna try to find the jump. It needs to be this one. This is my boring jump. Okay, can't be more boring, can't be less interesting. It's like, okay, oh, cool. But once I just bring a little bit of magic, it's where I can start doing things like this. Boom, pa. Okay. So this is where you start to motion editing with a very artistic perspective of how your character should jump. These guys are perfect, these guys are very tall, they need to jump very, very high. Makes sense for cinematics and gameplay. This is something I want to showcase very fast. I don't know what is the FPS of the streaming, but I'm gonna try. I got here a guy, which is all, by the way, motion capture. There is a couple of keyframe animation, but this guy that is moving there is coming with my body movements of Xsense. So this is, for example, combat animation. For example, you see there an animation of this guy. This is all mock-up. That's keyframe, that's mock-up again, and you can blend both depending on the situation. I'm gonna try to kill this guy, if I can. That's a mock-up. And again, it's understanding how these guys are gonna move. That's motion capture. I'm gonna go now to the, okay. So we keep motion capture for gameplay. And I'm gonna jump into a cinematic. Actually, we like to jump to the cinematic with the other character. Let me remove this guy. So we are also working in the same manner for gameplay and for shot specific cinematics. Let me take just one gun. Sorry, I'm playing. It's okay. Part of the job to play. So let's go to the cinematic. That's all motion capture from Xsense. It's the same animation, slowing down, artistic direction, making the weight, you know, feeling more realistic. And then it's gonna jump into a cinematic. Again, I recorded this in my living room with Facebook for the facial capture, Xsense for the body capture, trying to bring and understand the character. I know there is no audio, but we work with the actors to match my acting to the audio of the actors. Again, if this is based in MetaHuman Faces, we did a conversion using a technology of the company Raised by Monsters. We are really happy with the results. And yeah, we are using XSense both for gameplay and for cinematics. And now we go back to gameplay. And we got here all the motions I was showing you in Houdini and in XSense all together. That animation is new of the guys shooting, the guys dodging, jumps. I'm gonna die, but you can have an idea. I'm just gonna zoom in so you can see the animations there. You can see also the anticipation of the characters all the time. I'm gonna explain now why it's so important, anticipation, action, and recovery. So anticipation. For VFX and animation, this means if you are punching, this is anticipation. It means that the action is gonna bring weight. And this is very important to have a very realistic and impactful animation. Weight. Obviously, if you are in combat animation, even more. Then anticipation for player, for gameplay. It helps to have a punishment reward system, because if you are doing an attack like this, boom, and you don't have an anticipation, you are doing a kind of Super Mario Bros. Game, which is great. The moment you press, the moment you jump. But if you are doing a little bit more realistic, and let's say Dark Souls would be the extreme, where you have a lot of anticipation and then you do the attack, you are adding a gameplay event there that helps also to create opportunities or to punish the character, the player. If, for example, you do a big animation and the other enemy is going to attack you faster, is a way of creating a reward and punishment system, anticipation. And also for gameplay, when the anticipation happens in the AI, it helps to the player to understand what is going to go next. And this creates another gameplay situation that helps to bring richness to the gameplay. If you have just a guy shooting with no anticipation, you feel the game unfair. I don't know if you notice, I'm going to try to extend maybe 7 minutes. But the characters, when they do the fireball, they do this kind of motion here. I think I got the animation actually here. I think it could be this one. It doesn't matter. Anyone is okay. For example, this one is the ancestor that is going to get energy and then it's going to do this. Boom. Okay. So what is the anticipation? This. What I'm telling to the player, be careful. This guy is going to knock you down, run out, or block. The player blocks, the ancestor attacks, and you successfully block the attack. If I start animation here in my gameplay, I'm going to have this, I'm going to fall, I'm going to lose life, I'm going to feel frustrated because I didn't see the anticipation. It is quite important, not just in keyframe, in motion capture, to consider anticipation, action, and recovery, the three of them. Action. A walking animation loop is not just a walking animation. Action is tied to the persona, to the behavior, to the personality of your character. Remember how your character moves. Remember how is it all, is a kid, how it moves. I'm going to give you an example also in the jump, because I know that the jump is going to be 3 meters. I'm going to remove the jump. This is the original jump. You don't need to do this massive anticipation to jump 1 meter. Okay. This is how kids jump. Okay. Kids do a lot of anticipation because they feel very strong, but later biomechanics and physics, gravity, put the kid on the floor again, you know, so they don't jump so high. However, I knew this jump was going to be extreme, was going to be 3 meters. So if I see this, it doesn't make sense. But if I add this now, all this anticipation makes sense, because all this recovery, all this anticipation keeps the energy and release the energy in the jump. Okay, so that's why it's so important having these three areas very, clear at the very beginning, because are all connected. The anticipation defines the action defines the recovery. And then the recovery. Well, rehearsal, brief, I mean, in all the all the projects I did, we always do a rehearsal, we always practice. Not all the actors are martial artists. I got a martial artist background, so I love to train with the actors to, you know, train the choreographies, make them feel angry, make them feel happy, joy, sad. Before going to the volume or going to the accent suit, I always love to train the actors to the maximum. So yeah, that's very important, rehearsal before you jump into the suit. Be clear how, be sure that the actors know what they have to do, because I mean, I have to be honest with accents, because I had this at home, I can improvise a lot, I don't feel the same pressure. But imagine that you bring actors, that you have 3-4 hours with them, don't start improvising. At least improvise the interesting part, improvise on top of having a good scaffolding. You shouldn't improvise about, yeah, let's imagine what could be the backstory of this character. How tall should be this character? Do you think we should do something? Because that's improvising just the brief of the character, and that's not very professional. You can improvise though, like you have the brief and it's like, oh man, this kind of shaky movement, let's do it upside down because it's really great. Oh, why rather jumping forward? We don't do a jumping backwards. And then, you know, that's another kind of improvisation, knowing the character persona. And yeah, naturalism versus impressionism. This is depending on what kind of animation you are doing. If you are working for feature animation, you are working for video games, you have different kind of animation. In my case, because I'm doing a lot of combos and stuff like that, I this is motion capture by accents, but I motion edit it a lot. As you can see, I leave rooms to have an impression of when you can attack next. Sorry for the gun and sorry for the different assets. They are not part of the animation, but you can see the skeleton and have an idea. Every single in betweens gives the visual cue and input to the player, like I can keep attacking, attack, 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 and recovery. Okay, so I work in that manner. I can show you a video here about that. Let me see. This one. So yeah, here's the real animation. As you can see, there is not too much in betweens. I just do everything together. Obviously, there is a choreography there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But later, what I do is to start splitting the animation in different stages. That's the animation, the original. And then I bake and I leave a space in between. You can see that there with the different green areas on the bottom. And that's the space I give to the player to, you can attack here, you can attack here. You lose a little bit of weight, it is true, but you need always to balance responsiveness versus weight. Sadly, you have to choose. It's kind of hard having weight and responsiveness at the same time in gameplay. And yeah, that's later part of the combo you can see in the game already. What else? We're almost there. And then the recovery. Know what goes next to bring the intention. You know, you jump and you fall from 3 meters. Don't end your motion capture acting thinking, okay, I'm done, I'm going to just stop the motion capture. Think about the intention of the character after the action. If a guy is punching, don't do this. Okay, let's stop the animation. Don't do this. Oh, okay, that's done. Do the anticipation, do the action, and do the recovery again. You know, do the action, recovery, okay? Bring also recovery to your animations. It is true that modern game engines like Unreal Engine have blending transitions that can be used, but there is nothing better than real input from a real actor or yourself. Like having an attack and proper energetic recovery, okay? Or proper tired recovery, because maybe you fell from 5 meters and you are injured and you wake up injured. But the recovery is very important. And how character design impacts motion design is more or less what I want to summarize. Like your characters are not just the concept part, your characters are also how they move. It is very relevant and important. You need to train this and put this in your brain every single time. Because when you play a game, trust me, there is a big difference when you feel, oh my God, another motion capture library here. Oh my God, this motion capture is not directed. It's just generic. So it is quite relevant to do a very exhaustive research about the brief, about the concept part. talking with the concept arts before the motion capture session is quite relevant and important because they know how they move. And they, if it's a good concept artist, they will tell you, no, that bonder, it wouldn't allow to move that far. So character design has a really big impact in motion design. It is quite relevant, it's quite important. I can't stop saying this because, you know, I think now with XSense, we are in a moment that motion capture is democratized. And at the same time, democratization is great, it's awesome. I'm a full supporter of democracy. But the problem sometimes is like we forget the fundamentals, the scaffolding of motion, because it's so easy and so simple to have an XSense motion capture to do a retargeting into an skeleton in Unreal Engine that we forget that we are bringing souls, we are bringing characters, and we are telling stories. Otherwise, it would be just more like engineering or for medical animation, but we are telling stories, we are making games. It is important to bring the souls into your skeletons. And that's basically all the presentation. You can see more of this content in my different channels on YouTube and Twitch, Alvaro Real Time Mayhem. Both channels have the same name. If you want to contact me, again, I'm a little bit busy this October, November, December, but I'm going to try to catch up at some point with emails. That's pretty much it. Thank you so much, XSense, for this opportunity. I really hope to have more projects to showcase in the future. And yeah, happy to any questions and answer them.
Hi, Alvaro. Thanks for the amazing talk. Really, I mean, what I really love about it is that what a lot of gamers take for granted is something that uses a lot of pre-work to conceive. You know, everything you talked about is how much effort goes into making something, you know, realistic and lifelike. And I also liked to see, I mean, we haven't been using Houdini that much here at XSense, but it really shows how powerful that tool is. And I think I can actually tell you a little bit of a new story is the fact that I'm not sure if you're already aware, but we're currently working with Houdini on a Live Link plugin as well, which should be on the market pretty soon as well. So that might also be interesting for you. We do have some questions.
Yeah.
So let me first start off with a general question from Jeff. So Jeff is asking, are these presentations being recorded and available later? Jeff, yes, they are. They will be out in a week or two to be rewatched again at your discretion. So make sure that's the case. So Álvaro, how did the release of MetaHumans help content creators like yourself?
Yeah, for sure. It was, I have to be honest, in the moment MetaHuman was released, it created turbulences in our project for the good and for the bad. In terms of, I'm quite, I love character design a lot, like a lot. It's one of my passions in general. MetaHumans were like a groundbreaking technology. Mm-hmm. The problem is our characters were already done more or less with artistic directed faces. And I wanted to use MetaHumans no matter what, but at that moment when I was in the closed beta, there was not too much customization to have like stylized characters. Mm-hmm. However, in the last month, I contacted a company raised by Monsters like, hey, I saw what you did. I saw a video on LinkedIn. I saw what you did there. I saw that you stylized MetaHumans with custom geometry from ZBrush. Let's talk. We talked, and now we got MetaHumans back to the project fully there, with customized heads, fully artistic directed. And that's to me, the yes or no is how much I can direct geometry, how much I can direct motion, how much I can direct lighting. If I feel a limit, is where I put doubts. But right now I think with this technology and MetaHuman, I think what brought to the market is not just technology, is democratization of art and characters into games and VFX. And that's what is, I feel more confident in the future to see very powerful games, even in small companies, for sure.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think it's really bringing everything to the market and giving people the tools to create incredible content in the future.
Absolutely. For sure.
So Can you tell us when you expect CRETE to be released?
we have a kind of three kind of classic business plan, three scenarios thing, depending on how much we can fund the project and different ways of funding the project. In my head is always the 2 years threshold, Like the Seed of Juna was 2 years deadline. It was a 4 years project, being clear with you. The reason of this is like, I really enjoy doing the project. To me, it's not a delivery. I really enjoy doing the project. So the project is going to be delivered when I feel the project deserves to be delivered. Any investors and funding is going to be most likely someone that can trust in our own input, because there is always a risk when you do a project, a pilot, VFX or game, that obviously, oh yeah, I can fund this. Okay, can I choose the deadlines? Can I have creative input? I want to keep not the control, because control sounds like a little bit of, you know, being controlling. It's not about micromanagement. It's more about respecting the soul and the character of the game or of the movie. So yeah. Yes, in my head, 2 years. Now, if investors come, funding comes, things can change around faster, later, but that's what is in my head, depending on the situations, around 2 years.
Oh, good, good to hear. I mean, it's done when it's done, right? And I think that's very important, that you keep the essence of something that you create and love, and you want to stick as close to that as possible, which is really great, absolutely. So I have another question. Hi, I would like to ask Alvaro, how does he go about structuring cutscenes, story sequences for capture? Does he try to capture sequences as long as possible or break down into short parts and combine them later? Any tips on dealing with drift over long sequences? When capturing a long sequence, a character doesn't arrive to the point it started moving from.
I mean, that's a big thing. I did a couple of YouTube videos, and also they can check the Insight Unreal I did, I think 3 weeks ago, where I showed the how I work with the sequencer. The classic vague answer, it depends. Sometimes you can just, I shoot just the action, and sometimes what I do, and this is related with the slide where I said I do library motion, what I do is to, if I'm doing a cinematic, I try to be as close as I can to the idea of the storyboard and the cinematic and just shoot that. However, I love also part of the real time, what is the best of the real time are the moments that are not real time. And what I mean by this, mean that, okay, I put the motion capture of the shot, let's say the guy walks and say, hey, you come here, and that's the shot. But now, while I'm in the sequencer, I love to add bits of maybe extra animation, extra shaking, extra weight, and that's more like layered animation. Yeah. Either can be layered or can be one take and then the other. Let's say you do this shot like, hey, come here, and then you stop the shot in a very awkward moment, and then you prefer just to raise the arm down, to put the arm down. So maybe I have an animation that I put later on. But for sure, 90% is what I have in the storyboard and the cinematic. But layer animation and libraries are quite relevant, because it's so important to have a beautiful performance that painting your shots. You need to think about any artistic exercise like painting. You paint with lights, you paint with concept art, of course, you paint with motion, you paint with gameplay. It's like having a palette and putting the concepts on top of each other until it looks cool. Because even if you have Brad Pitt inside a suit, as a director, you can say, I would like this to be retained 80% speed. And you can do that. It's okay. It's part of the idea. And that's why I do a lot of motion with XSense libraries of everything I can imagine, just to later put that. Oh, yeah, now it looks with more weight. So, yeah, it's a mix of depending on the situation.
Yeah. So it's really sculpting up to the desired result that you're aiming for in the end.
Well, one small note, when I was working at ILM, doing crowds. Crowds is, I mentioned at the very beginning, brought the best of game and VFX, because we are in a hybrid artistic technical situation when we do crowds with a lot of libraries. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we work at ILM, I think, I mean, it's completely disclosed because there's an article about the system arcade we got there. We didn't simulate crowds, like doing a simulation. We painted motion. You had the frame of the camera, and we painted guys walking. We put a layout of guys cheering up, or we put like, we paint the shots more than simulating or keyframe animating or going into the technical aspects. You want to paint your shot, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good. So we're up to our last question, actually. So the question is, what is your opinion on the Houdini viewport playback speed, especially with a lot of nodes?
Well, it is true that it's not the best compared of obviously a game engine. But what I try to do is, I don't need to see the lighting. I don't need to see the high-res viewport. I go to the occlude all the lights. And what I do is to skip in frames in the bottom left just to see the real animation, even if I'm not playing at 60 FPS or 24 FPS. I use the motion capture for gameplay at 60 FPS. But being honest with you, I'm happy seeing the FPS at 30 in Houdini because my workflow is so fast. Once I got animation in Houdini, it takes me 10 seconds to see that in Unreal Engine. It's quite straight. So if I want to double check, for example, let's say high frequency motion like shaking or a spasm, I just export that fast, I check in Unreal Engine, and it's like, yeah, this looks pretty all right, let's move forward. So I'm not finding a problem with the speed of right now of Houdini, because again, Houdini to me is not the final output, it's the in-between, so any extra changes I can go to Unreal Engine, of course, and that's more or less what is working for now. Can be improved, as any software in the industry can be improved.
Of course.
We just need to wait and see how the different viewports and things improve in the future. But right now, I feel okay with that, to be honest with you.
Well, who knows? Maybe a person from Houdini is listening, so, take this advice and and maybe do something about it. So, Alvaro, thank you very much for this inspiring and great talk.
Thank you.
I loved it every minute. I hope all of you guys love that as well as much as we did. Again, thanks again for tuning in, and hopefully we can see you with our last talk. Haz Dulul will be doing his talk at 2 o'clock Central Eastern European time. So hopefully till then, and Alvaro, thanks again.
Thank you. Bye bye.